So, great presentations going on today. We thought we'd take a slightly different angle. Instead of actually presenting something today, we've decided to give y'all a little lesson in how y'all can all become better leaders. And therefore, sort of picking up the role of power and being an effective leader. It's interesting, over the last couple of days, we spent two lectures on leadership. How to be a good leader, what can we do, what are the to do's, not to do's, should we eat this in the morning, should we not eat this in the morning, too many things. We thought we'd simplify it. We picked one topic which all of us can try and master today. And that's what we're going to talk about. So we've obviously gone through a lot of work doing this, hundreds of journals, this, that, and the other. Everyone's done it. So we won't talk about it. Let's move on. The agenda today is what is leadership? Some forms of power that we're going to talk about. The balance between personal and positional power. This is important because we also will illustrate through case studies how it is important for the power to be absolutely balanced for a leader to be effective. We've got a little test that we've decided to do in the middle to show you all how it's actually done. And obviously the leadership and its influence on organization. So we'll just kick it off with a little teaser for you.
Sir, report one. Report two.
Good, sir.
Shut up!
Sir, put in a reservation desk on line 2.
Yes, I would like to book a table for 2.
Sure, sir.
Poolside.
Your name, sir?
Hari Sadhu.
What, sir?
Hari Sadhu.
Sir, me, eh? Yes, write down Hari Sadhu. H for Hitler, A for Arrogant, R for Rascal, I for Idiot. That's right.
Yes, so, who wants a boss, his or her boss like this? Definitely, I don't want somebody like this. So now coming to the leadership, what the famous leaders say about leadership. As per Eisenhower, leadership is the art of getting someone else to do something you want done because he wants to do it. Whereas Bill Gates says it, as we look ahead into the next century, leaders will be those who empower others. Whereas John Maxwell says in his words, leadership is the power of one harnessing the power of many. Now, these are the famous quotes of the famous personality, what they have said. But the main thing is all three were of diversified nature. Eisenhower was a president of USA. Bill Gates was a founder, is a founder of Microsoft. Whereas Maxwell is an author whose writing mainly revolves around leadership. So all have different perspective of leadership. But one thing is common in this. All focuses on power. All correlate the leadership with the power. So what it is, what is the between leadership and power? Is there some bridge or how it is linked? We have studied various cases, we got to various journals, and then we just tried to connect the dots between the leadership and power. So we finally come up with, leadership is a process of using power to obtain interpersonal influence. So now leadership we have known, and what is power actually? Is it something like muscle power or something else?
Thank you. So at this point, let's go a little more in depth to understand what exactly is power and what are the various forms of power and its influence on leadership. So the Oxford Dictionary says that the power is actually the capacity to direct or influence someone's behavior or any sort of any course of events. At this point, let us take a minute to actually recap the different forms of power and how they actually relate to leadership. Let's just have a quick recap before we actually look at the further part of the presentation. So French and Raven actually proposed 5 different forms of power, which were classified into positional power and personal power. So basically, positional power was classified into coercive power first. So let's just take a minute, think about Gaddafi. So you can actually think of his coercive regime in Libya. So I think that is a very good example of coercive power for us to actually relate to. The next thing we will look at is legitimate power. So you can probably think of Barack Obama. So Obama is actually known for his status in the United States of America because he is the president, of course. So he's known for his legitimate power. The next example is reward power. So reward power is basically you get something done for you in exchange for actually giving something to someone else. I think let's have a quick thing to relate to this.
You don't have to worry about that, Mark.
So, okay, the other form of power is personal power. So, personal power basically, the first thing is expert power for us to consider. So, you can think of Warren Buffett. So, he is an expert in corporate finance, and I think he's known across the world for his expertise in this area. The next form of power is referent power. Think of Arnold Schwarzenegger. And I think he is where he is today because everybody likes him and everybody wants to be like him. So at this note, we're going to introduce a very interesting and very important concept which is relevant for all of us in our business lives in the future. It's essential to make sure that you bring a balance between positional and personal power. So it isn't important if you just have your position or you have authority, but it's also important that you weigh that against personal power.
What Ashwini told, let us see pictorially. It's a balance, legitimate power, which is a form of positional power, and a personal power, that is expert power. If a leader does not balance it properly, it could lead to various failures in his leadership style. And in the case studies that we are going to deal further, we will show you all how one power, if was misused, it lead to a severe downfall of that leader.
So yes, to actually add to what Naseem said, I think the greatest challenge to all of us in the future and leaders existing today is that you need to learn how to balance positional and personal power. And studies actually show that personal power is actually very important in addition to positional power to make sure you bring about organizational change, employee satisfaction, performance and commitment. So at this point, we will probably understand this concept a little more in detail by looking at a couple of case studies and understanding how in some instances where the balance actually worked really well and those leaders were successful, and we will probably look at another case study where everything just went wrong because the balance didn't really exist. Thank you.
Thanks, Ashwini. When we were actually brainstorming on leaders, we couldn't think about anybody else other than Steve Jobs, the man who invented the built-in empire from his dad's garage. And as for today, Apple is worth around $700 billion, which is actually more than Standard & Poor's 500 companies. Okay, now we look at various powers of Steve Jobs. To start with, we look at his expert power. As you all know, he's a technical expert, which gave him immense power among his employees. Going on, we look at his reward power. As head of the most valued company, Jobs had reward points both within and outside Apple. Now, in terms of his legitimate power, he's the CEO of Apple, so he had immense legitimate power. Now, coercive power. Along with Apple products, one of the other things which Jobs was famous for was how he pressurized his employees to get work done by them. So, but if you look at it overall, he portrayed a good mix of both positional as well as personal power, which made him a phenomenal leader. Now, we got one more person to look at. Salman Khan, not the guy from So Salman Khan is the founder of Khan Academy. It's changed lives of millions of people, millions of students, both from Africa to Middle East. In fact, I remember referring to Khan Academy during when I prepared for GMAT. So various powers of Salman Khan. Start with, we look at his legitimate power, founder of Khan Academy, and he's also voted as one of the most influential people by Time Magazine for 2012. Referred power, So how Khan Academy works is a non-profit organization. So it gets funding from almost top companies in and around the world. Now his expert power, he started off as a hedge fund analyst, got his degrees from both Harvard as well as MIT. Now again, if you look at it, you can clearly see that, you know, he's got a mix of both positional as well as personal power. So it's a fine balance, which again makes Salman Khan a great leader, not an actor.
So coming on to the negative side of how power can be misused, like we have seen two good examples of how leaders can balance their power and be successful in their lives and their career. But we had a hard time finding a negative example, but yeah, we finally got a good one. So Kali Fiorina, she had immense power, as legitimate power. Like she was the CEO, president, and chairman of the board of HP. She was a Fortune. She was the first female CEO of a Fortune 20 company, and the most powerful woman in business for 6 years in a row for Forbes magazine. And also, she was a very dynamic and headstrong leader. Looking into the expert power, she has an excellent track record with HP. She was the CEO for 7 or 8 years running. And notable achievements were merger of Compaq and HP. But the problem lied with her referent power. She was not very likable with the shareholders, the public, and the stakeholders, board of directors. She ultimately lost her image, public image, and finally, the way she as of now also like she's looking into entering politics with Republican Party in US, but still she is not able to find that likability in herself, and finally that led to her downfall in her career, as well as personal and her career path also. So this was a disbalance between her referent power and the expert power. So this leads to for us to say, like, how the disbalance between different powers can lead to a failure in your life. Next. So let's test what we have learned in this 10 minutes now. We have designed a small switch test here. Let's see how it goes. This is basically for to see how the leaders force, not force, how leaders influence their organization cultures. Sure.
Right. So what we've learned is, a leader has various paths. He has to balance those paths to be an effective leader. But what is actually a leadership? It's the way he brings his culture into an organization. And that is what we're going to test. We're going to test if we switch a leader with his culture from one industry to another, what will happen. That's why we thought of it, we call it the switch test. What we're going to look at is working at Facebook versus working at Berkshire Hathaway. So I'm sure all of you all have heard about Facebook. Some of you all are on it right now. But how would it be working on Facebook, working with Facebook? That's what we kind of went ahead and looked at. The Facebook office in Sydney is something similar to this. It's not too far away from here. Pretty interesting. You can see a lot of colors, a lot of lively things. And then we went to the Berkshire Hathaway office. Watch out. Not that great. But anyway, what was important over here is how Mark and Warren look at this. They look at it as an extension of their own personality. The company imbibes the culture that they want to carry forward, and that's what they're really looking. If you look at it even further, it can be, and you look at Mark's office, he wasn't in at the time, but it's vibrant, it's got, you know, things going on, it's more young, it's more youthful. Warren, on the other hand, doesn't have a computer in his office. He still communicates with his entire staff via written letters. We didn't get a chance to see his handwriting, but we can assure you it's pretty good. Moving on. What do you think would happen if we switch them? You take Mark, who's got the culture of having fun, people wearing shorts, working out in the gym, in the office, and you throw him into the Berkshire Hathaway office, where people are every day wearing formals, presenting to people much better than us, but still, all of that going on. What do you all think will happen? What will the switch be? Disaster, right?
Yeah.
This is what we thought a good picture of a disaster would be. People totally dressed up working out. So what do we take away from this? And this is important for all of us. So when we go out and when we want to be future leaders, we need to have an optimum balance of both the types. types of powers that we possess. If there is an imbalance in the type of power, we have a higher probability of not being as great a leader as we have the potential to be. It is important for us to balance power, and therefore it is important for us to take this as a lesson moving forward. Obviously, we didn't come out of this thin air, so we've referred a lot of journals, and this is probably a lot of inferences that we've made. That's it. Thank you.
Exceptional presentation, exceptional. Just one question. What if in the switch test, Berkshire Hathaway people go to Facebook? How is that going to be?
Actually, it'll look the same. They'd be wearing suits and working out in the gym.
And how are the other around?
Gym, right?
Yeah, so Facebook people going to Berkshire Hathaway again?
No, I mean, it would be something similar. So you have the organization.
So Facebook culture. Guys will be attending board meeting in shorts.
In shorts.
Pajamas. Will that be better? I think so. It's more Berkshire.
What is interesting over here is if this switch happens, what will happen next? So will the company actually do better and respond? Will the employees respond and do better? Or will they go the other way around and actually leave
the interesting.
What you all said
want
is disaster.
Yeah. So obviously it's something disruptive that a leadership style is. So until Google actually had innovative offices and innovative spaces, nobody really thought of it. IT company was go to work, switch on your laptop, type of.
Don't even go there.
Okay.
But I think the outcome is contingent. It depends. It depends on the situation. It depends on the perspectives and different employees.
The key takeaway is also that everybody, like you, are all future CEOs, CFOs. So you have to balance expositional and personal power.
The point you made was quite an interesting one there, because I think there'd be a level of discomfort, wouldn't there? Because people are used to wearing suits to work, they're being told, like, you saw Google coming in pajamas.
They enjoy wearing shorts.
Well, the others might not enjoy seeing them, because I think it's a big age difference as well. So it depends on.